What is a basic survival tactic slash rule slash lesson that everyone should know? Stay still after a car wreck unless there's fire. Moving around can worsen any potential spinal injuries. No matter what condition your car is in, if there's any chance of a spinal injury, the fire brigade will still take the roof off and the paramedics extricate you in various braces to prevent movement. Hey, former EMT here, yes, and please allow emergency responders to examine you and treat you on the scene, if they deem it necessary. Shock is a hell of a thing, and in the immediate aftermath of an accident, you might feel the urge to leave the scene or resist help if you do not have an obvious injury. Remember that we're trained to assess for signs of head and spinal problems, internal bleeding, and other serious injuries that you might not be able to perceive on your own, and we're there to help you. I agree with this one. My brother and I were driving home late at night and we stopped at a closed petrol station to stretch our legs and switch drivers. I was looking at the road and saw a totally normal car driving towards the station and my gut told me to get out of there. Told my brother to get in the car and close the doors. Turned on the engine and started driving and the car drove past us with three creepy ass guys staring at us. So glad we left on time because I don't know what they would have done. But it sure as hell was not selling us a cookie. It's disputed. One theory is suction. Another is that air released from the wreck reduces the density of the water so you are no longer buoyant. Others say both are myths. What is undisputed though is that floating objects that get dragged under then rip free will shoot to the surface and could injure you or knock you out. If it is clearly sinking, foam, but stick together. But being in the water is a bad situation anyways. Try to get onto something. Life raft, floating wreckage, anything. If someone tries to force you into a van slash car slash alleyway whatever in public, now is the time for maximal resistance. Also yell, scream, get others' attention. They are trying to move you into a location where they have more control and safety, and you have less. This is your best chance to escape. Also, stop using your legs to hold you up, bend your knees or go completely limp. It's not intuitive. But try this, grab a friend, with consent to the experiment, and pull them backwards. They will use their legs and most likely will actually walk themselves backwards because it's natural to do that. If you feel you are going to fall backwards, this makes it quite easy for you to pull them with you. Then try again and tell them to go entirely limp, or let their legs go rubber. Now your victim is not helping you. You have to support more of their weight. Meanwhile, hopefully your victim is using their arms and hands to poke your eyes out. Not as easy as when the victim is standing. So, go limp. That is a decent tactic, but only if you utilize it right away and if the person, if it's only one person, isn't that much bigger or stronger than you. The reason why the timing is so important is if they're a bigger person and they grab a hold of you, spend some time trying to lift or drag you. You're already giving them plenty of resistance. Suddenly going limp like that while they're enacting that much force will more times than not backfire and they'll just pick you up or start moving you a lot easier. Now you find yourself with almost no leverage and are hoping for a fantastic kick or punch to a sensitive part of their body. I have spent a lot of time with experts in the DNCIA who, back when they were younger, lead cases in South and Central America focused on gang activity. Lots of experience with kidnappings and other horrible situations in which tactics like the one being discussed here are practiced, so no time is wasted. In a situation of somebody trying to drag you into a dark alley or their van, we're talking a matter of seconds total. So suddenly choosing to stop resisting and giving them 3-4 seconds of almost full control seals the deal unless you successfully go limp at the moment they try to move you. My dad repeatedly told me this growing up and still does. If they're threatening you with a weapon, call their bluff and fight like hell to keep from getting in the vehicle. Whatever is going to happen to you right then and there is not near as bad as what is going to happen should you make it into the vehicle and be taken to another location. You joke, but I kind of do this in social outings. I don't drink, and when people start getting rowdy and want to move on to the next place, that's my exit, especially if it would rely on not having my own transportation to get there. Back from the stories I hear, I've dodged a lot of riffraff in this approach. On that note, there's an old technique of cutting off the barrel diagonally for a good 6 inches, not removing any length, just opening up the barrel. It makes the barrel into almost a sort of bayonet, but that's not the intent. The intent is if the guy reaches out and grabs the barrel, he's likely to grab over that slant cut, putting his hand right smack in the path of the shot. When he grabs the gun, you just pull the trigger and relieve him of his hand. Have some sort of fire. Fire is the number one survival rule. You can cook food, boil water, keep you warm, keep away predators. Fire. It's the biggest morale booster in a survival situation. I was on a 3-day backpacking trip and I had 2 lighters fail on me in a snowstorm. From now on, I always buy a brand new lighter and keep some matches with me. I don't mess around when it comes to fire. I had the TSA take my ferrocerium rods last time I flew. I said that they were striker rods that couldn't work without knife, which I obviously couldn't have on the plane. And the TSA guy said, "So you make my argument for me. These are a knife," referring to the ferro rods. I wouldn't trust the TSA to follow either their own rules or common sense in any situation. Here in the upper Midwest, I would recommend a pair of snow pants, hats, gloves, and a small shovel in winter. You never know, especially when the roads are icy and snow covered. I'd rather lose trunk space to that than risk frostbite or even freezing to death because you got stuck or had car trouble. I have a little box in the car with tea candles, lighter, bottle of water, roll of toilet paper, tape, plastic bags, important phone numbers written down, you name it, just a little survival kit. I don't really live in a cold area, but better be prepared. When fall hits, I also put a fleece blanket in the car. The kids love it for the first few minutes when the car is still cold, but in case of an emergency or a serious traffic jam, it can help keep you warm too. Scream, yell, and curse like your life depends on it. Because it does. On a related note, the point where you stop defending yourself from an attacker is when he's on the ground and not moving. That doesn't mean dead, but does mean doesn't move. Hit, punch, scratch, wherever you can. Soft areas like eyes, throat, and groin are bonus points. If you are going hiking, pack extra water and drink it. As simple as that. Dehydration can quickly lead to disorientation, and I forget the exact facts, but a good percentage of hikers that get lost report having a headache before they lost their way. And headaches are one of the first signs of dehydration. Drink your water, please, people. Also, read a map before you go. GPS is great, but it makes people not care where they are and they have no real big picture of where they are going. Read a map, bring a compass and a whistle too. With that big picture in your head, you'll know generally if you get lost, which direction you should head to get back to safety. A whistle carries further than you're trying to scream and requires less effort. Both fit in your pocket easily. And yes, bring water and toss a few snack bars in your pack. I always carried Snickers bars before I had kids who are allergic to peanuts. Bring a jacket too, even if it's hot. If you are in the wilderness and need to sleep, do not sleep on the bare ground. You'll quickly become hypothermic. There's a reason bed rolls, sleeping bags, and hammocks were invented. If you have no camping bed, you can pile up leaves and brush, like a proper mattress thick pile, and lay in it to create an air pocket, buffer between you and the ground. This is arguably more important than being able to build overhead shelter or even being able to start a fire. Never let someone take you to a second location. The chances that they would actually shoot you in the parking lot of the Piggly Wiggly, where witnesses are present, are small, but better to be shot there than in some godforsaken field 30 miles out of town. You will be found quickly and there will be cameras and witnesses to gather evidence. If someone wants to remove you from a public location, it's because they want to do something to you that will cause you harm and send them to prison. Experts in kidnapping say never be coerced onto a vehicle. Literally do anything to avoid it, or you don't get a choice about going to that second location. They even said don't get in if someone is pointing a gun at you. Just run. Most kidnappers don't want to hang around and chase you down or shoot at you. That wasn't their goal. Even if they did shoot while you're running, they are nervous and it's harder than you think to hit someone on the move. Any move to fight slash escape slash run slash evade has risk. But the worst risk of all, statistically, is complying and letting yourself be forced into a vehicle. Along with the three right turns advice, I've been told that if you think you're being followed, put your turn signal on and see if the person behind you also does this. If they do, skip the next turn and just go straight. If they turn, you're probably in the clear. If they don't, you're most likely being followed. Call the police immediately and do not under any circumstances drive home. One time, I was followed by someone because I cut them off after they blew a stop sign, merging into the lane I'm in. They felt in the right to run the stop sign and cut ahead of everyone, so the fact that I sped up and got ahead of them was infuriating, I guess. The guy rolled down his windows and was shouting every word possible on how I'm scared and afraid, and wait until you get out of that car to see what happens. I'm gonna beat your ass. I promptly turned around, proceeded to drive 10 minutes down a straight road to my local police station after telling him have fun following me there. I get to the police station, he's still behind me. I take a left at the light to turn into the station and then I look in my mirror and the car was gone. Who's the person that's afraid now? You really have to watch out for destructive people. They'll take anyone down with them on the fall. Unless the guy following you is just going home and you just happen to turn down the right streets. I was going home just the other night and I really think this happened. Guy in front of me had out of state license plates and it just so happened every time he made a turn, it was where I was going. We went into a subdivision, then he turned into a place with a cul-de-sac so he could turn around. I literally had to sit there while he turned around so I could park at my house. In most of the world, we drive on the right side of the road. So if you take a right turn, the very worst that can happen is a side swipe from traffic on your left going straight or head on traffic turning left. You will never get hit by traffic from your right when you are turning right. If you go straight, you could get hit from any direction. The cars on your left could hit you if they go straight or turn left. The cars head on could hit you if they turn left or even just swerve. And the cars on your right will always hit you if they don't stop. If you turn left, you cross paths with all head on traffic no matter what way they're turning. Traffic on your right will cross paths if they go straight or turn left. And traffic on your left will cross paths if they go straight or turn left. It's all about how many paths you cross and then assume there's always a chance someone doesn't stop. Sure, left turns, in some situations, such as busy cities, are roughly 10 times as dangerous as right turns. So it's actually safer to make three right turns than one left turn. https://www.washingtonpost.com/news/innovations/wp/2014/04/09/the case for almost never turning left while driving/. Since that article has a paywall, here's a relevant excerpt. Federal data have shown that 53.1% of crossing path crashes involve left turns. but only 5.7% involve right turns. That's almost 10 times as many crashes involving left turns as right. A study by New York City's transportation planners concluded that left-hand turns were 3 times as likely to cause a deadly crash involving a pedestrian as right-hand turns, and 36% of fatal accidents involving a motorcycle involve a left-hand turn in front of a motorcycle, according to the National Highway Traffic Safety Association. Of course, it takes longer. However, if you multiple stops to make, and you have a computer calculating your route ahead of time, you can ask the computer to find the route that is mostly right turns, while minimizing left turns. It turns out this reduces risk, reduces time idling while waiting to turn left, and even minimizes fuel usage. Another quote from the same article: UPS has chosen to minimize and sometimes eliminate left-hand turns to be more efficient. The company says the changes have helped it save millions of gallons of fuel. Today, this is a standard feature in commercial routing software. UPS uses their own proprietary software, called Orion. Read about its right turn optimization here, but as far as no all commercial grade routing software does this nowadays. It's kind of a must-have feature. Consumer grade software like Google Maps doesn't have this feature because it rarely makes sense when just going from point A to point B. But you can usually get the same effect by simply going straight when it tells you to go left and making the next available right turn. It will recalculate the route to include the next 2 right turns. I recommend you do this if there's a left turn on a busy street that doesn't feel safe to you for any reason. If you're interested in maximizing safety, there's an option: tell Google Maps to avoid highways. This will prevent it from telling you to get on a freeway for just a mile or two. It selects these routes because they're 1 or 2 minutes shorter, but it's usually way less safe to merge onto the freeway than to just take surface streets. I once had a pretty stubborn creep following me one time. The dude wasn't even trying to not be sketchy. Black Charger, no tags, kept headlights off. I did the right turns and even passed through some really public places. Police department wasn't an option. There's no cops at night on weekdays and none at all day or night on weekends. So as a last ditch effort, I called my friends while briefly at a stop sign and told them to meet me at a really busy 24/7 gas station and let me know when they get there. My friends are roommates, so they live in the same house. The creep finally left once he saw 2 big dudes come greet my car. I wasn't going to get out unless I was sure the follower left. My friends played it pretty cool, acting like they were wondering where I was at and mentioning a fake aunt. I was followed once and before getting to my street turned a left, then backtracked and then turned down a back alley. He matched all the turns but didn't follow me down the alley. I went very slowly and when I got to the other end his truck was there waiting for me. I pulled in behind him and put on my high beams and moments later he buggered off. I got suspicious of the characters when they quickly got into their truck at a corner store while I waited at a red light, and then followed the rest of the route. They must have heard the stereo I had in a fun little Honda Civic hatchback and I'd replaced so many stolen sound systems by then. When driving, always be aware and anticipate what other vehicles might suddenly do and think ahead how you should react if it happens. In the beginning you need to consciously endorse this mindset, but later on it will become a habit and you will become better at it. Also, never ever text or even look at your phone while driving. One day you will kill somebody, possibly yourself. If you find yourself in an unfamiliar part of a city while alone at night, or really any time when it seems like sketchy things might be going down, walk and move with the purpose. Eyes ahead, confident strides, like you've been to that barred window corner store up ahead 1,000 times in the past. Anyone looking for an easy mark will key in on insecurity in a heartbeat. Even if you can swim, always float. Never try to swim back to shore, you will die from exhaustion. Edit: lots of you have said swim and float, which is good if you're not too far out to sea. However, If you are too far out, swimming will not do anything, the rip currents will get you. If ever you go swimming in the UK, don't go past the pier. And if you find yourself that far out, even being the strongest swimmer will be futile. Source: please don't swim, float. Safest way back to shore is swimming on your back. Use your legs to frog kick and swoop your arms at the same time. After the surge, point your toes and leave your arms by your sides for a second or two until you feel the current subside. Then do it again. Try to relax in between kicks. If you flutter kick, you will tire out very fast. Breathe in and out deeply, but naturally. Arch your back and you should float.